Hello everyone, my name is Brad Voss and I will be moderating today's webinar. Thank you for joining the introduction to the TruSight HLA sequencing panel. Following the presentation and a brief software demo, we will take questions through the webinar Q&A. With that, I would like to introduce Alex Lindell, the Senior Market Manager at Illumina for Immunogenetics.
Thanks, Brad. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I'm really excited to tell you about TruSight HLA, the product that's now available for ultra-high resolution HLA sequencing using Illumina next-generation sequencing technology. I'll cover five topics in the webinar today. First, I'll go over product overview and performance. Then I'll talk about Illumina's next-generation sequencing technology, followed by the TruSight HLA workflow and library preparation, and then give more details about the kit configuration and the different kits that are required to run the assay, and finally talk about the Connexio Sign software that was developed in collaboration for TruSight HLA analysis and reporting. For those of you unfamiliar with Illumina, our mission is to advance human health by unlocking the power of the genome, and we decided to pick the most challenging region of the genome for this product. TruSight HLA is a single solution for HLA sequencing, high-resolution, unambiguous, phase-resolve HLA sequencing. It includes the TruSight HLA sequencing panel, which is all the reagents necessary to perform library preparation and load the DNA onto the MiSeq for sequencing, and then the Connexio Assign software is incorporated into the TruSight HLA kit for analysis and reporting of the HLA types. To give you a little bit of sense of the performance, we used the International Histocompatibility Working Group samples here at Illumina. We chose 117 samples from the consanguineous panel so that we were getting broad representation of homozygotes within the samples that we looked at, from the SP panel looking at many different allele combinations and allele representation. And then we chose Ceph trios that had IHWG reference typings available for them so that we could look at inheritance as we qualified the assay in the assay performance. So we calculated three different statistics: concordance, which is simply concordance with the known typing result for that sample. However, concordant results may also be ambiguous. So given that, we then also looked at identity in two different identity statistics, first being identity, which means the result is concordant with no ambiguities between common well-documented alleles. And then finally, we looked at identity, which is concordant and no ambiguities at all, common or rare. Concordance, we achieved 99%. I will also explain the gap there between 99% and 100%. And for CWD identity, we were essentially at that 99% with one common well-documented ambiguity that I will also explain. So on the common well-documented ambiguity, the one ambiguity that exists in the panel is a DRB4 0103-0103 null, which is the null allele SNP is located outside of our amplicon. The resolution for that has been widely published. So the null allele is seen exclusively in haplotype with a DR7 and a DQ9, so a DRB107 and a DQB10303, and we're confidently calling those alleles, so it's rather straightforward to resolve that ambiguity with no additional follow-up testing. On the concordance side, we looked in those 117 samples, we had a total of 1,510 alleles with references from IHWG workshops. 55 of those we found to be discordant. 40 of the 55, we had really strong evidence that the reference typing was incorrect. For the most part, those were class II alleles where bringing in exon 3 sequence or exon 4 sequence modified the result. So the reference, it wasn't that the reference typing was actually incorrect, it was just that the reference typing was based upon partial sequencing. So 2.6% of the total we felt had incorrect or incomplete reference that was modified with the TruSight HLA results. We have been diligently trying to confirm that with orthogonal assays on a different technology, so mostly Sanger and sequence-specific oligos and sequence-specific primers. Thus far, we have only been able to get assays to confirm 11 of those, but 11 of those were confirmed that the TruSight HLA result was the accurate result. The other 29 we have not yet confirmed. We are still working on confirming those. Those have been removed from the analysis, so they weren't included in the analysis. An additional 11 of the 55, or about 1% of the total, showed novel sequence that made them discordant with the reference typing, and many of those we have been able to confirm and are working on confirming those. The remaining four discordants required a few manual edits, and with those manual edits were then concordant. In addition to the battery of tests that we put samples through here in qualification of a new assay at Illumina, we also recognized that we wanted external feedback in how the assay performed. So very, very early on, we brought in two alpha sites. These alpha sites have now sequenced over 120 samples and at least six runs per site. And these sites selected all their own samples from their library of samples that were available. All those samples had reference typings available, mostly from Sanger sequencing with either SSO or SSP confirmation. We looked at a very broad range of allele combinations, ensuring to include that we got at least all 184 known antigens, but we went far beyond that in those 240 plus samples. We looked at different sample types, so we looked at buccal samples, cord blood, peripheral blood, and cell lines. We looked at novel alleles. We also looked at some really crazy biology that you wouldn't typically see, like for instance a third HLA allele present from a leukemic blast cell with a different HLA type. We were able to pick that up as well. After the alpha study was complete, we went into a beta study where we brought in four additional sites. Each one of those sites has performed at least 30 samples. Again, those samples were all selected by those sites. Again, we asked for broad representation of allele combinations. We asked sites to throw hard samples at the assay and not just kind of typical samples that you would ordinarily see. We were really eager to test the limitations of the assay. We looked at reproducibility. So each one of those sites did 30 samples across at least three runs to calculate reproducibility, coverage, and different sample qualities. This shows the coverage of the different amplicons. So we have 11 amplicons or 11 loci that we're sequencing, ranging in size from 2.6 kb on the smallest end to 10.3 kb on the large end, so 62 kb of total sequence when running all loci per sample. On the right-hand side, you can see a graphical view of the coverage. So in most cases, we're covering the entire gene, and in some cases, we're covering all the critical exons and the intervening introns. Next, I'll go through a few slides for those of you that are unfamiliar with Illumina's next-generation sequencing technology. So our recommended sequencer for this assay is the MiSeq. We have two MiSeqs, the MiSeq and the MiSeq DX. These are our instruments really targeted for targeted sequencing or focused power. So the first step in preparing DNA to run on a sequencer is to fragment the DNA, and we're fragmenting the HLA loci into 800 to 2,000 base pair templates. These templates or fragments are then bound to the flow cell and then clonally amplified into a cluster. The MiSeq has flexibility and can support runs between 1 million and 25 million clusters. 500 base pairs in total are read for each cluster, and for this assay, 250 base pairs from each direction. So we read in one direction, we flip the molecule or flip the entire cluster, and then read from the other direction for paired and 250 base pair sequencing. The MiSeq's actually capable of going to paired end 300 base pair sequencing, and we've tested the limitations of the assay and did not feel that we needed that increased read length to get the types of results that I presented to you earlier. So the sequencing starts with your template DNA with a sequencing primer aligned to that. We flood the flow cell with fluorescently labeled nucleotides with dye terminators. The dye terminator labeled nucleotides are added one base at a time, sequencing by synthesis, or Illumina SBS. After each base is incorporated, a picture of the flow cell is taken, and you can see a representation of that image here on the right. The dye terminators are removed, and new nucleotides are added, and one more base is added, and a picture is taken again. Each one of these is called a cycle, and for this assay, we're doing 500 cycles. 250 cycles in one direction, then we flip the molecule and do 250 cycles in the other direction. The flip looks like this, so we read our read one, 250 base pairs again, we flip it and then do read two. This is what we call paired end sequencing, and this is critical, and this is how we resolve phase ambiguities that you have been plagued by in the past. Because the templates are clonally amplified into clusters, you know that a variant under read one and a variant under read two are on the same molecule and therefore are in phase with one another. So this paired end sequencing is what allows us to resolve these phase ambiguities. This is our HLA sequencing strategy. So we isolate and amplify each gene individually, and then we fragment. We randomly fragment using the Nextera enzyme, and those random fragments are randomized both in the location where the fragmentation occurs as well as the length of the fragments. So again, we're looking for fragments somewhere between 800 base pairs and 2,000 base pairs. Those fragments are then clustered, and the clusters are read 250 base pairs in each direction, represented here in green and red. Sorry for those of you that are colorblind. I realize I should have used different colors there now. The key here is not to make sure that the reads overlap. The key here is to try and get as much distance between the reads as possible, and that's what allow us to bridge these large gaps of desert with respect to heterozygote positions that we can use to align phase. So our goal here was to get great distance between the reads. This is an example of that. If you have three allele-determining variants, you have one read here where variant 1 and variant 2 are in phase with one another, and then another read showing that variant 2 and variant 3 are in phase with one another, and therefore you know that variant 1 and variant 3 are in phase with one another, and so you can directly phase the variants or all heterozygote positions across an entire allele or an entire locus. There's no imputation happening here. This is direct phasing, no linkage or anything like that. Direct phasing, highly accurate, reliable phasing. To put this into perspective for you, for each one of these loci, the number of reads or the number of clusters per loci is in the tens of thousands at least, if not the hundreds of thousands. Next, I'll talk briefly about the library prep step and the ultimate goal of library prep. So here's what a library looks like. On the ends of each library are the P5 and P7 adapters. These are the complementary sequences to the lawn of oligos that are attached to the flow cell, and this is what allow the libraries to attach to the flow cell. Within those adapters are the index primers. These are the barcodes that allow you to put multiple samples and multiple loci, and then after sequencing, those index sequences are used to assign each read to the appropriate sample and ultimately the appropriate locus within that sample. Then there's a read one and a read two sequencing primer. These are the sites that initiate the sequencing by synthesis that I showed you in the previous slides. And then in between all that is the template DNA that you're ultimately trying to sequence. So the goal of TruSight HLA library preparation is to get your DNA into this format so that you can load the sequencer and perform the sequencing. So the library prep starts with long-range PCR. This is late in the day of day one. It takes about an hour to set up all the long-range PCR reactions, and then they will run on the thermal cyclers overnight. The next day you come in and you perform NextEra library prep. NextEra is Illumina's enzyme or transposome, which performs tagmentation, which simultaneously fragments and ligates all the sequence adapters, index barcodes, and sequence primers that I showed you in the previous slide. This is about an 8-hour day with about 6 hours of hands-on time. At the end of this day, you're ready to pool the library and load it onto the sequencer and let the sequencer start doing its work. Again, the sequencer will perform 500 cycles using the version 2 chemistry. You have a couple different options available on the version 2 chemistry. You have the nano flow cell, which does 1 million clusters, or the full-size flow cell, V2 flow cell, that does about 15 million clusters. The nano will support up to 6 samples of all 8 libraries per sample, and the standard flow cell will support 24 samples of all 8 libraries per sample. I'll give you a little bit more detail about that in a few slides. The nano flow cell takes about 24 hours to complete, and the standard flow cell takes about 39 hours to complete sequencing. In the next few slides, I'll talk about the kit configuration and different kits required to run the assay. So the end-to-end DNA to report workflow is 4 days. Again, you start late in the day of day one with the long-range PCR. Day two is the library preparation using NextEra and bead-based size selection. At the end of day two, you load the sequencer. The sequencer will run through day three, and in the morning of day four, you're ready to load the results into Conexio and start reporting them. Because the assay requires about 6.5 hours of hands-on time, we've partnered with Beckman to fully automate the assay using the Biomech FXP instrumentation. It's a fully automated library preparation. It's been pre-configured into 6 independent sub-methods. This allows you to run different portions of the library prep on different instruments. So you could have an instrument in pre-PCR and an instrument in post-PCR and easily separate those sub-methods between those two different instruments. We've done extensive testing on the automated platform. It's highly reproducible between automated runs. It's also highly reproducible when compared to manual runs performed here. You have a number of different options on the Biomech instrument. For instance, you can get on-deck thermal cycling, or you can use a scaled-down system where you pull the plates off to do thermal cycling off-deck. This is currently available. A tech note will be available on our website within the next couple weeks. The kit is configured. It has 4 boxes that are shipped. The boxes are divided into pre-PCR and post-PCR, and then further separated by their storage and shipping temperatures. The frozen will be shipped on dry ice, and the refrigerated ones will be shipped on gel packs. After you place an order, you will also receive an email. The email will include a link to download the software from the TruSight HLA support page on Illumina's website, and it will also have a license attached that you will be asked for during the installation of that software. The kit supports the creation of 8 libraries per sample. Each library is its own locus with the exception of DRB. The DRB library will sequence DRB 1, 3, 4, and 5. So in total, you're sequencing 11 loci, and you're preparing 8 libraries to sequence those 11 loci. The TruSight HLA kit supports 192 total libraries per kit. So if you're running all 8 libraries per sample, you can get 24 samples out of the kit. We have provided a lot of flexibility within the kit in terms of how the reagents are filled. So if you only wanted to run A, B, C, and DR beta, you can run those and get 48 samples out of the kit, still producing 192 total libraries per kit. We've also overfilled the DQB1 primer so it can support up to 48 libraries per kit, whereas DP beta, DQ alpha, and DP alpha support only 24 libraries per kit. In order to run the TruSight HLA sequencing panel, you need 3 kits from Illumina. You need the TruSight HLA sequencing panel kit. I've shown the catalog number here. Again, this supports 192 total libraries. It includes all of the PCR primers and the reagents for PCR. It also includes sample purification step, so there's no additional kits required to do sample purification. That step is optional, but all the reagents are included. It includes all of the Nextera library preparation reagents except for the indexes, and I'll explain that in a second. And it also includes the Connexio assigned software within that kit. So when you order the TruSight HLA kit, you get those four boxes plus the software included. In addition, you'll need the Nextera index kits. We have four sets of index kits available, sets A through D. Each kit includes 96 unique index combinations. Each one of those index combinations can be used up to four times for a total of 384 libraries per index. So you will need two of these per kit if you are going to run all 24 samples. So for 192 libraries per sequencing run, you'll need two of these kits. If you're only going to run 12 samples or 96 libraries per sequencing kit, then you only need one of these kits. So by having four kits, we give you a lot of flexibility in the number of samples that you're going to perform per run. Finally, you need the MySeq reagent kits. These are the reagent kits for the sequencing as well as the flow cell that you load onto the sequencer. We have two 500 cycle kits available. We have the standard kit, which is the 2003 catalog number you see here. Again, that can support up to 192 libraries per sequencing run and has a runtime of about 39 hours. And then the nano kit, which can support up to 48 libraries and has a runtime of 24 hours. Next, I'll describe the Connexio software that we have worked in partnership with Connexio to develop for TruSight HLA analysis and reporting. The Connexio Sign software performs five primary functions, and the first three are all automated. Initially, it will align every sequence read to a locus consensus sequence. That locus consensus sequence is an amalgamation of all known HLA sequences for each locus. Once the alignment is complete, every heterozygote position is phased, as I showed you earlier using the paired end sequence data. The phased alignments are then referenced against the IMGT HLA database to produce HLA nomenclature typing results. Those first three steps are all automated. Once that's complete, fully audited reports can be generated directly out of the Connexio software. There's three key features of the software. First is that we quickly give you access to all the critical information. So on the initial screen, you'll see all the typing results, the depth of coverage for each locus, and the sequence quality for each locus. For more information, you can go into the next screen, which gives you a wealth of information, and I'll cover all that information on the next slide. And then finally, there's no bias here. We've no bias to common alleles, no bias to the reference, there's no black box. We provide visual information of all the data that's used to generate the result, and then the results are ranked ordered on the results screen, so you can look at all the different possible combinations as well as base-by-base call information. So here's all the information that's available visually for you to see and use for decision making. The top row here is all base-by-base information, and then the bottom row is result-level information. So the base-by-base information, we give you the base call and the frequency of the base call, the depth of sequencing at each base position, the base call quality, the phase and the phase alignment, and read diversity. All this is graphically presented, so there's no need for calculations or more in-depth analysis in other screens. It's all provided visually on one screen. In addition, you have all the results information, so alignment of the sample sequence to the reference sequence for each reference that's ranked in the results, the coverage of the reference sequence in the IMGT database, since a huge number of these references do not include full gene sequence. You also have mismatches to the reference, and I'll show you this in the software in a few minutes. You also have information about whether or not the reference is a CWD reference or a rare reference. And then we also provide you with the sequence of the reference. Again, all of this information is graphically presented in a single interface for really quick decision making. In addition to those features, Connexio has a robust user management system. It allows for multiple levels of reviews, audited editing, audited reporting, and tracking of everything that's done within the system. So you can produce audit reports to see everything that's happened with a run or with a sample and the users that were responsible for those. It has very flexible installation architecture. You can install it on desktops, laptops, servers, and you can do mixed installations within the same facility, and there's no limitations from licensing or software on the installation options. It also gives you the ability to load a run and then save the run as a Connexio genomic project file. These can be then reloaded into the software very quickly with no additional analysis, and they can be loaded without an active license. Finally, in the licensing that we provide with the kit, you have an unlimited number of users, an unlimited number of systems, an unlimited number of samples, and it will support mixed installations, as I mentioned earlier. The license has a minimum of 3 months available from the purchase date. With that, can we bring up the Connexio assignment? So when you load samples into Connexio, this is the first screen that you will see. Along the left-hand side here, you have all the samples that have been sequenced, as well as the loci sequenced for each sample. You have the typing results presented here. All homozygote results are presented with a yellow to indicate that it's a homozygote. In addition, you can navigate then to see the sequence quality. And here you can see we're using a Q30 score. Our goal is to have over 75% of the base calls at Q30 or higher. Q30 is one error in 1,000 base calls, or 99.9% consensus accuracy. As you can see, we're well above that threshold in almost all cases. If it drops below 75%, you will get a red warning showing you that it has dropped below 75%. That's a very rare occurrence. On the next screen, it shows you the depth of coverage at each base. The depth of coverage for each locus. This is the average depth across the entire locus. Anything below 100x average depth of coverage on this screen will result in a red flag warning. So you can quickly see whether or not you have a depth of coverage issue. For the most part, we're well above 200x depth of coverage at every locus. Going back to this screen, it gives you a quick view of all the different typing results that are available, and you can scroll down to look at the additional samples. If this is all the information that's required, you can quickly report out these results by choosing to print a summary report. And that summary report, I just created in an Excel, but you have the option to export as text and XML as well. And the summary report will give you that summary information, all the quality information, as well as the coverage statistics. For more information or to look at problematic samples, you can dive directly into the coverage screen by clicking on the sample itself or using the show menu to go to the coverage screen. I'll click on the result and access the coverage screen. The screen that I mentioned earlier that's showing you all the detailed information in a visual way. So I'll start at the top and work my way down to explain all the different components of the interface. So across the top here, you have the amplicon coverage. If it's white, that means you have, at those positions, greater than 100x depth coverage. The red shows you positions where you've dropped below 100x. At the beginning and the ends of the amplicons, you would expect to see this gradient as the coverage ramps up, and the black shows no depth of coverage or sequence outside of the amplicon. Here you can see a black position within the amplicon, and this represents a deletion in the data, no actual issue with the sequencing. The next row here is the actual structure of the locus, and you can click on either of these top two rows and move the view to cover those regions. So here we're looking at this portion late in exon 2. Below here, you have information about the reference database that's being used from IMGT, and then this is base position information of the selected base here, and I'll come to that in just a minute. Again, here you have all the samples that were sequenced. As you click on the sample, it will show you the loci that were sequenced for each one of those samples. Over here, you have the review hierarchy. So the R means that the result was generated and is reportable. First reviewer, second reviewer, and confirmation that all base positions have been confirmed that were flagged. And then finally, the C column is for comments that you can leave between reviewers and comments that you can make visible on the report. Here you have the ability for more granular navigation by sliding the window below that, and I'll give us some more space here. Below that, you have the sample consensus sequence. This is what I mentioned earlier, and I'll just head to the beginning of the exon here. The sample consensus sequence in white is non-coding sequence, and in yellow is coding sequence. Anything highlighted in blue are base positions that are sometimes available and sometimes not, so these represent deletions and insertions in some alleles of the HLA-B locus. This uses the IUPAC degenerative base designations, and you can find those definitions here in the navigator in this drop-down menu. I'm going to skip these next few rows and come back to them in just a minute. Using those same base designations, this is the sample consensus sequence coming from the TruSight HLA prepared libraries. And then below here, we have the phase alignment of that sequence. And so that you can see the C and the T and how they are aligned with the other heterozygote positions. Coming back to these rows here, these are the reference sequences. So I'll bring these references back in. The top reference here is a B08 and a B40, and you can see that the C was assigned to allele 1 in the top row, the B08 and the T was assigned to the allele 2, or the B40 in this case. And you can see this same phenotype when you look at the other loci as well. This row here is a confidence indicator, so if it's in white, it will mean that the call is a high confidence call. Anything highlighted in red is something that would require manual inspection and confirmation. Anytime an edit is made, it will show up here in this black row. And so for this, I will just show you to make an edit. If you believe the T here is a missed call, you can simply click on the T and indicate that you are calling a homozygote A at this position, and it will show you then that you are mismatched with this C0701 allele. And it has flagged that now as an edit that was made. Given that that was appropriate, I'll just bring that back. Below here, there's two critical pieces of information. First are all the base call and the base call frequency information, and then the depth of coverage for each base position. So I'll start with base call and base call frequency and then show depth of sequencing. From the top here, color-coded are the major allele. G is highlighted or is represented in black, T in red, A in green, and C in blue. The minor allele is represented below here on this log scale. So 1% to 10%, 10% to 100%, and 100% to 1,000%. Sorry, I said that wrong. 1% to 10%, 10%. 10X. I said it wrong again, sorry. 0% to 1%, 1% to 10%, and 10% to 100%. So you can see here the minor allele frequency is about 50%, and you can see the minor allele here, and these base calls are in the noise. This pink line here is dynamic filtering of the noise, and so what we're looking for are base calls that rise above the noise and achieve the frequency of the minor allele. In addition, these gray bars here, these gray vertical bars, show the depth of sequencing at each base position, and that's on the log scale here in parentheses. I'll get it right this time. 0x to 10x, 10x to 100x, and 100x to 1000x, and so here we're looking at about 250x depth of coverage going to near 300x depth of coverage. And so you can see a consistent depth of coverage well over 100x at every base position as you scroll through these loci. On the right-hand side here, we have the results, and this provides a rank order of the results as referenced from the IMGT database. For this sample, you can see here we have an 0304 and an 0701, and it takes it out to the fourth field. It does look like with this information that's available here, we have a fourth field ambiguity, and I'll show you how to resolve that if you're interested. So in this first column here, we have mismatches within the core. So I'll show you this. So as I go to the core in class 1 is exons 2, 3, and 4, and any known expression variants. So sequence covering any expression variants, whether or not it's in the core exons, other exons, or an intronic and non-coding sequence will be pulled into the core. This allows us to eliminate expression variants without having to expand into the non-coding region each time. As you can see here, there are a number of ambiguities if you just look at the core information. So by clicking on the core header, you can expand to look at the remaining exons, and those remaining exons here are highlighted, and you can see this shows, again, no mismatches, but we've dramatically reduced the number of ambiguities, and now we no longer have even any third field ambiguities. We only have fourth field ambiguities. To resolve those fourth field ambiguities, you can further expand to the non-coding region, and now the non-coding regions resolve those ambiguities. Just to show you an example here, if I click on this pair, I can navigate to this single mismatch here. And what this is showing me is for this 03, 04, 01, 02 to be the correct typing, we would expect to see a C at this location. We call the homozygous G. There is no C available at this. There's not even one read with a C at this position with about 100x depth of coverage here. So again, confidently, you can rule out that call. And here we have, no sequence mismatches. In addition, we're also showing you mismatches in phase, and so we're seeing no phase mismatches. This final column, the differences column, shows you the differences between the top-ranked allele pair and these secondary-ranked allele pairs. So here you can see the 03, 04, 07, and the 070144 have no sequence mismatches, but they have a phase mismatch, and that phase mismatch is in exon 3. So next I'll show you how to report these results, and then we can go look at a few more challenging samples with novel alleles. So to report these results, you can hit reports. Again, you have the option of a text-based report, an Excel-based report, an XML report, as well as a FASTA output. You have the ability to filter by sample and to filter by locus. You can sort by the sample ID or the locus. You can limit the number of fields to two fields, three fields, or all available fields. You have the option to limit the results to the full allele list. This is what I usually use, but if you want to restrict to P groups or G groups or NMDP nomenclature, that is possible also. Over here, you have the full report options. So the summary is what actually provides the typing result. You also have the ability to provide auditing. Then in the layers, you can actually print the sequence information, any edits that were made, and any mismatches that still exist. You have the option to limit what audits you report, and you also have the ability to set different mismatch limits. Here I have it set pretty stringently, so I'm only going to report allele combinations that have zero mismatches or are the best in the absence of zero mismatches being available. You can increase your mismatch limit, and you can increase your best or best plus one, best plus two. For the sake of time, I will just do a single sample. And I will report all of these different fields. Here you can see you have the date created, the reference that was used, and the CWD set that was used, the sample name, And as we scroll down, I'll look at the B allele, which is the one that we were looking at. And you can see it calls the 080101 and the B400102. I didn't use any of the review sign-offs, so those will all show as failed and when the sample was saved. Then it prints the actual sample consensus sequence. No edits were made, and there were no mismatches. Same thing for the C allele, but this time we had made an edit, so I'll scroll down so that you can see how it marks the edit. You can see that the admin user made this edit at base position 451.
You didn't share your Excel screen, Alex?
Oh, okay.
Sorry, just realized what the technical challenge was.
I see. Okay, sorry, the Excel screen was not shared, and that was causing problems.
Yep.
Okay, let me stop sharing altogether and then come back. Okay, let me start that over since you couldn't see the Excel screen as I was going through that. So I'll just start with the C locus since that's the one where we made the edit. So that summary section here reports the C03040101. And the 070101. Again, if you had just selected summary, this is all that you would see. But we chose to do the auditing report. We didn't use the auditing features, so the first and final review show up as fail, and I didn't confirm any of the base positions. It also shows you when the sample was saved and who saved it as I was logged in as the admin. Then it will show you the consensus sequence, so I chose to have the and I had made an edit and then reversed that edit. It shows me the position at which that edit was made, the edit that was made, and who made the edit. And then you can see here that I reversed that edit. And it does that, again, then for every locus type. So I want to leave plenty of time for questions, so I'll quickly just go show a novel allele, and then we can move on to questions. So going back to the summary screen, I can scroll down here. And take a look at this one that has an ambiguous typing. And as we go in here, we see that the best matched pair is an 010201 homozygote, but there is no position in which there is an allele pair with no mismatches. All the core exons are okay, but the additional exons have mismatches. So I'll navigate to this single mismatch at position 2272. This is an exon 5. The base call here is a homozygote A, and the expectation at that base position is a G. You can see, actually, we have a single read with a G in it, not enough to overcome the other 275 reads that we have that have an A in it. So we have not called the G, and it does appear that it is not an 0102 homozygote. As we scroll through the gene, sometimes you can look at exon 2 here just to make sure that you're really confident that's a homozygote with no minor allele above above 10x frequency, we can pretty confidently say that this is a homozygote. So the next option here would be to look at the next highest ranked homozygote. Again, you still have this 2272 mismatch with that combination, and the 286, and now a 2861 mismatch where it's expecting an A, and we call it a homozygote G with not even a single A read available at that base position. So with confidence, you have a novel sequence here. We have confirmed this novel sequence with additional follow-up testing. And this was actually from a consanguineous trio where we were able to see this inheritance pattern in other family members. So with that, I will stop the demo, and we will go to the Q&A and take questions.
Well, thank you, Alex. So there's been a number of questions from the Q&A panel, but as we are going through this, please send more, and we will go through them. The first question I have is, what is the minimum recommended depth of coverage required to get a reliable typing result?
That is a great question. We set a pretty conservative flag at 100x depth of coverage. So anything that drops below 100x average depth of coverage per locus will get flagged. Any base position that drops below 100x will also be flagged at a base-by-base position. However, we have seen situations where getting lower than 100x depth of coverage still produces a really high-quality result. One of the labs we're working with has set their threshold at 80x, and we've even seen typing results as low as 20x. But if you follow the specifications, you really should never see dips in coverage below 100x. In fact, most of the time, the typing results, except at the beginning and ends of the amplicons, are well above 200x depth of coverage.
Great. Next question I have is, how were the software updates, specifically database updates, made available to the customers?
So in partnership with Conexio, we update the IMGT HLA database every January and July. Those database updates will be made available to customers on the TruSight HLA support page, and I'll show you that quickly. To get to the TruSight HLA support page from Illumina, you can simply go to the Illumina homepage, type in HLA, go to the support section, and go to TruSight HLA sequencing panel. All of the information is available here publicly, and in the download section, we will update the software configuration files here. That's both the IMGT database updates, again, every January and July, as well as any updates to the CWD list. Those are user downloaded and then can be installed in the software by the user on their timeline, and that's very simply done here through this updates button where you could update the references, the nomenclature, and the CWD files without having to reinstall the software.
Got it. Another question. What are the data storage requirements for TruSight HLA?
A 24 sample run will produce FASTQ files somewhere between 1 gigabyte and 5 gigabytes of total data storage required.
Okay. How many PCR machines are needed for the long-range PCR if you're running all 11 loci and 24 samples?
3 thermal cyclers will be required to perform 192 library preps of all 11 loci.
Great. And what is the runtime on that long-range PCR program?
It runs overnight, roughly 35 cycles.
Correct. So, another question that we got is, can the Conexio software run on macOS?
It runs on Windows operating system. We have had some people run it in parallels on a Mac, but it does require a pretty robust system to run the software in that configuration.
Can you go into slightly more detail on library prep? Because I know that you covered it in the slide, but can you expand a little bit on kind of what the major steps are to that library prep?
Sure. As a follow-up to that, one great way to get that information is from the TruSight HLA support page and go to the documentation and literature section. We have 3 different user guides, the reference guide, which is overwhelming detail, and then the protocol guide, which is a scaled-down version of that. And then once you have experience running the assay, you can use the checklist, which is basically a 2-page step-by-step protocol. So after the long-range PCR, one of the beautiful things about this assay is we use a lot of beads. The beads alleviate the need to do quantifications and requantifications to get the DNA quantity and dilution correct, so we're using beads for cleanup and beads for size selection. It gives us really robust size selection and is quite a simple, straightforward assay. So I think at this point that's as much depth as I think we need to go in on this call, but for those of you that are interested, you could download these reference guides and get all that detail.
Wonderful. Can you give a little bit more specific information on what automation, what has been automated in the automation option? What pieces of the protocol have actually been automated?
With the Biomech FX system, the entire protocol has been automated, and they fully tested it completely automated. So all the pre-PCR steps, all the post-PCR, all the thermal cycling has been automated and can be automated on deck on the Biomech instrument. You have, of course, options to have a less expensive system and do some of that work off deck. So, for instance, we've also run it in the configuration where the liquid handler is only being used to do the pipetting, and then you'll pull the plates off for the thermal cycling steps. But it is, again, the pipetting portion of the assay being the most challenging piece, so that can all be done on the liquid handler. We have had other labs that have automated on other systems, but the Biomech automation is what's currently available. It's programmed, and those programs are available to customers.
Great. Does Illumina use one index per locus? And if so, why don't you use one index per sample for all of the loci that are amplified?
So we do recommend one index per locus, with the exception of the DR-beta library, which captures all four DR-beta loci. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. So we use one index per library, or one index per locus, with that exception of the DRB library. We did test using pooled, where we pool all the loci for one sample, and the level of concordance dropped when you did that, and your utilization of the sequencing reads dropped because you were having to make a decision between throwing out reads that ambiguously aligned to multiple loci. And for instance, when working with B and C, you just couldn't put all those reads. You just couldn't get the depth of coverage, and so your ability to multiplex samples dropped dramatically, and then ultimately your accuracy dropped. So in the future, I do think it is something that we will enable for high throughput customers that don't need the high level of accuracy. But for labs requiring incredibly high levels of accuracy, our recommendation is to keep the loci separate so that you don't have to make the decision to align a read that is ambiguous.
So how much DNA do you need for each amplification, as well as how good a DNA quality do you need for each of our loci?
Okay, I'll take the second question first. So DNA quality depends on which amplicons you're interested in running. Assuming you're going to run all loci per sample, the biggest amplicon is a 10 kb amplicon for DP alpha 1. So you want to make sure that the DNA, at least 50% of the fragments in the DNA sample are over 10 kb in length, and that will allow you to amplify that DNA and capture all those steps. For any DNA samples that are questionable, we do have an optional upfront DNA purification step in the protocol, and the reagents for that purification step are included in the kit. So any questionable samples, we would recommend running those kits. But for fresh buccal and fresh blood samples, we haven't seen the need for upfront purification. The amount of DNA required is 50 nanograms per library. So if you're running all eight libraries per sample, you need a total of 400 nanograms of DNA.
Have we validated the kit with buccal swab DNA?
All of the samples that we ran internally and what we were able to qualify internally were from blood, because we were using the IHWG samples. We have had some beta sites that used buccal swabs and cord blood as the sample type, but we have not been able to qualify that as a supported sample type. But again, we saw no degradation in performance at the external sites that use those inputs.
Okay. So another question, have you ever seen problems in intron 2 to exon 3 using Nextera? Have you seen any unevenness of coverage using the Nextera technology of the TruSight HLA panel?
Yeah, so many of the labs that were looking at creating an HLA sequencing solution on Illumina Next Generation Sequencing used the off-the-shelf Nextera XT kits to do that. Those kits really weren't intended for this application. Mostly they were used for microbiology type purposes. And one of the reasons we decided to make this kit is we felt we could solve the problem that a lot of those labs were having, which was drop in coverage at that location. It is the noisiest location, and you will see quite a lot of noise at the end of intron 2 going into exon 3, but it should not affect the typing. One of the ways we overcome this inherent fragmentation bias that you see with all enzymatic fragmentation technologies is that we are using longer inserts. So those longer inserts will help overcome that fragmentation bias. In addition, the long inserts have a really positive side effect that it allows you to bridge the gap between long distance between heterozygote positions. So there was two reasons that we chose those long inserts.
Great. There are a few more questions, but we are out of time. So there is an FAQ available on the TruSight HLA support page on Illumina's website, so please visit illumina.com and search for TruSight HLA to quickly locate the support page. In addition, we will be hosting regular webinars and case examples. Thank you for joining the webinar today, and thank you so much, Alex,